had some, we have a mud yard right now. So the May newsletter, beautifully done as always by Diana, was emailed out last Monday. If you did not receive that, there are paper copies in the fellowship hall, or if you'd like to be put on the email list for the newsletter, give DK a call in the office, because that's where you need to go to find out what's happening here at Leo, and there's a lot happening. And the other thing is that in the newsletter and on the slides, there are what I would term calls to action. And most of them say, call Debbie Smith if you want to help. And I sure would like to get some phone calls because I haven't gotten any lately. So I hope you'll read through the newsletter and check out the announcement slides, which also play in the fellowship hall after service, or actually all the time. On Saturday, May 15th, 2 weeks from today, make note, there's only one worship service, and that is at 10 o'clock. And it's going to be followed by a church-wide brunch potluck. So bring any dish you'd like to share, and then also bring your cell phone, your tablets, your laptops, or anything that you use, because we're going to unveil the new website that day, and you'll want to learn how to navigate it. Junk in the trunk, next Saturday, and we're going to all pray for nice weather. And it is from 9 to 3, and there are also food trucks available that day. So even if you don't want to shop, you can come out and eat. Spring Work Day at the church on Saturday, May 21st, from 8 to 12, and there are plenty of jobs that anybody can do. A lot of helping hands will make the work go faster, and the fellowship is always rewarding. There is something new at the Grable Food Bank. They have recognized that prices are going up, and it might be a little more, a little tougher for those of us who are 62 and older on fixed incomes to get what we need at the grocery store. So if you are 62 or older, or you know someone who is, the first Tuesday of every month, you can go now and get groceries. They'll give you a shopping list, you check off what you need, and they'll load it in your trunk for you. So that's a great opportunity. So be sure you pass that along, and if you know in advance that you have a friend or if you're going to go, let me know so I can tell the food bank to be sure they have plenty of food on hand. Now, today we have a guest speaker. I'd like to introduce him. He's Ed Fenstermacher. And over the last several months, the discipleship team has been bringing you guest speakers to share their testimony. So, and the purpose behind this is that you can feel a little more comfortable in telling your story to others, because that is how we spread the love of Jesus, by telling each other what Jesus means to us. So Ed is a longtime United Methodist who loves the church and Jesus Christ. He lives in Fort Wayne with his wife Marlene, and they attend Faith United Methodist Church, which is on Clinton as you head south out of town, or as you go through town. Also, since 1995, he has served with the Indiana Conference as its Associate Director of Church Development, where he leads the conference's efforts in starting new faith communities. And I've been privileged to know Ed for many years. We used to go to church together at Covenant United Methodist Church, and I always love it when I can be partnered with him in various seminars and things, and I know you're going to love hearing from him. But at this time, let us stand and praise God with our first hymn of the day, and that is The Church's One Foundation.
The church is one foundation. It's Jesus. It's so good to have you here. I'm so glad that you've chosen to visit and to be with us this morning. Let me introduce myself. I'm Pastor Jeff Smith. I'm the senior pastor here at Leo United Methodist Church. And what a great privilege it is to be with you this morning. As you already heard, we've got a wonderful witness coming. I've known Ed for a really long time. I'm really anxious to hear what he has to say, even though I know part of the story at least. Ed and I go back a long way. We met probably at least 15 years ago, if not 20, and worked together closely on a group of congregations journey. My understanding is that you guys took a vow at one point in time, and so we've got lots in store for us this morning as we go deeper in worship. But one of the ways that we do that is that we prepare our hearts, amen? So let's do that right now. Let's prepare our hearts to go before the throne of grace. We'll do that with some silent, reflective time. We'll have a pastoral prayer that together, collectively, as God's people, we will say the Lord's Prayer. Are you ready? Let's do it. Sit here as your people in silence, our own thoughts focused on you as individuals. And I'm reminded of Elijah because that's when he heard you most clearly, and it was a whisper. It wasn't in the noise and the tumult all around us. It wasn't in the hurly-burly of the world, or it certainly wasn't in the conflicts that we have to deal with every single day. It was in the silence. And your voice, O God, spoke most clearly, most forcefully, and the loudest, in a whisper. But to hear that whisper, O God, we have to slow down and be still and listen for it. We thank you for this opportunity to hear your voice, this calling of hard time that the rest of the world calls it Sunday, a day to sleep in. We call it our power charging station, for this is where we reconnect with you in a way to renew our flagging spirits and also to energize us for the mission field that you called us to enter into the moment we leave these doors. So we ask you to bless us today, not just because we need it, although that's true. We ask you to bless us today so that we indeed might be in a position to be a blessing to others. For we are bridge builders. We exist to build bridges between people, your people, O God, and your Son Jesus. Equip us, empower us to do just that. And now together, we pray this ancient prayer that Jesus once taught his disciples, as together we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
us with him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. So God can point to us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness toward us, as shown in all he has done for us who are united in Christ Jesus. For God saved us by his grace when we believed, and we can't take credit for this. It is a gift of God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus, so we can do the good things he has planned for us long ago.
It is a real privilege to be able to come to you this morning and to share my a little bit about my faith journey. It is really a joy, and I would just say that I hate to tell you this, but I'm a pretty ho-hum guy, and my story is pretty ho-hum. So my mom and dad were missionaries. They were Methodist missionaries at Congo and Nome, Alaska. And their stories were awesome, and you should really hear their stories. But they're dead, so you're stuck with me. And the reality is that I've lived in Fort Wayne for 38 years, married to Marlene for 35 years, worked at the same job for 27 years. I'm pretty boring. For breakfast, I have every day of the week the same breakfast, except Sundays. I have pancakes. The other days I have cold cereal and a piece of peanut butter jelly toast. Now let me just tell you, isn't that boring? I mean, but guess what? I use crunchy peanut butter, so I'm not that boring. But the God that we're here to worship today, I remember making a commitment to follow. Years ago when I was 5 years old. 5 years old. I remember that day. I was in Nome, Alaska at a Baptist children's club, and they asked if any of us wanted to commit our lives to Christ. And I remember that night, that afternoon, making that commitment. Now, 5 years old, obviously I had no idea what that meant exactly. But I do remember telling my mom and saying that I had decided to make Jesus my best friend and the Lord of my life. And so I've been following Jesus for a long time, and I don't have any story like Paul, Apostle Paul, you know, Damascus Road, big change. I have known Jesus growing up in a Christian home forever. But the same God that called me is obviously calling each one of us today, right? And many of you in here have said yes to say, Jesus, I want you to be Lord in my life. And I can just tell you that no matter how ordinary you are, that a life with God, a life following Jesus, is going to be extraordinary. And so I have just a few things I want to share with you today. First off, I just say a friend of mine, he says that people all over the world are asking two basic questions. Now think about it. What are those two questions? People in South America, people in Asia, people in North America, Christians, non-Christians, we're all asking two questions. What are those questions? Am I lovable? Am I valuable? And the other question is, do I have a purpose? Is there a reason to get up this morning? Those are two fundamental questions that my friend believes that all of us are asking. And did you hear the scripture read this morning from Ephesians, Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus? It says, now God has us where he wants us. Mm. With all the time in this world and the next to shower grace and kindness upon us in Christ Jesus, saving is all his idea and all his work. All we have to do is trust him enough to let him do it. It's God's gift from the start to finish. We don't play the major role. If we did, we'd probably go around bragging that we've done the whole thing. No, we neither make nor save ourselves. God does both the making and the saving. Am I lovable? Are you lovable? Absolutely. That's why God came and died for us. 2 weeks ago, we celebrated Easter, right? God came in the flesh. Why? Because God values each one of us. We are each one so important that God came in as Christ, suffered, died on the cross, and rose again because we are truly valuable in the eyes of God. And if you look at verse 10 in the scripture today, it says, for we are God's, what? Masterpiece. Think about that. We are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Did you get that? We're God's masterpieces. He doesn't view us as boring or ho-hum, but as masterpieces. Tell your neighbor, you are God's masterpiece. Go ahead. Tell your neighbor, turn. We got to turn. We got to open your mouth. You are God's masterpiece. Yes, you are. And each of you should say to yourselves, I am God's masterpiece. God's masterpiece, but the reality is we don't always believe it, right? I mean, think about it. Are we really God's masterpieces? I don't know about that. You know, we fall short, don't we? We don't measure up. Well, many of us have tapes in our heads that say we're second best, we're not that good, maybe due to our parents or peers or whatever. I remember I enjoyed school. I'm sort of odd. I don't know about you students here, whether you love school, but okay, I see a so-so. The one class that I did not love was, guess which one? Phys ed. Because in phys ed, a lot of times, they're picking teams, right? And when they're picking teams, guess what's going through your head? Okay. I know I'm not going to be picked first, but will I be picked last, right? I mean, that's what we're all thinking. And it's like, oh, gosh. And when you hear your name, it's like, oh, thank goodness, I wasn't the last person. Well, many times I was the last person. So, you know, when you're not picked first, many times you begin to get in your head that you're just not that good, right? I remember in phys ed, there was a kid that was picked on, bullied by the other students, really abused. And I feel bad today because I never stood up for that person. You know, there are regrets, right, that we have in our lives. Regrets from things that we didn't do, maybe, that we should have done, or things that we maybe hurt other people. And so how in the world could we be considered masterpieces by God? And yet, the scripture today says that we are. And we are because, guess what? In God's eyes, being a masterpiece doesn't depend on what we do, but who we are. Because we're a child of God's. We are created in God's image, and God loves us, not for what we've done or haven't done, but simply because he loves us. Isn't that amazing? You know, there are struggles. I mean, we all struggle with something. none of us have it all together, right? Yet God, out of sheer love, has chosen us to be his masterpieces. In Deuteronomy 14:2, it says, God says to the Israelites, out of all the peoples on the face of the earth, the Lord has chosen you to be my treasured possession. We are God's treasured possessions, his masterpiece, but for a purpose, for a purpose. Are not like masterpieces that are in a museum hanging on the walls. God calls us a masterpiece, but then has a plan for us, a plan for our lives. One of the favorite verses of mine in the Bible, the one that sort of has guided my life, is John 15:16, that says, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. God has chosen you. The answer to that second question, do I have a purpose to get up in the morning? Is there a point to this life? The answer is yes, because God has chosen you to go and bear fruit, and there's a plan in the scriptures today in Ephesians that says that he created us to do the good things he planned for us long ago. God has a plan and you're part of it. Now, I'll just tell you, it's not always easy to figure out what that plan is, right? I mean, I know I struggled when I was in my 20s trying to figure it all out. And when I was in college, they asked this crazy question, like, what major do you want to graduate with? And I was like, do I have to choose something? You know, I had no idea what God wanted me to do or what I wanted to do. And so, when in doubt, go into teaching, right? That's what I did. I went into teaching. I taught high school English. And I remember as I taught, in year three, after I finished year three, I began realizing that all the other teachers loved what they were doing. They loved the teaching, all of that. But I just was loving the church work that I was doing on the side. And so I began feeling a nudge from God, you know, maybe you aren't in the right fit. There's nothing wrong with teaching. That, I have a son who's a teacher, and oh my word, I'm so thankful because God is using him in huge ways. God can use us wherever. But I just had this nudge from God that I was in the wrong place. And so I actually wrote God a letter. Have you ever done that? Wrote God a letter? And I said, okay, God, if you want me in church work, I never felt called to be a pastor, and I'm not a pastor, but if you are calling me to work through the church, you'll let me know by June the 1st, okay? That was pretty specific, right? Not June the 2nd, June the 1st. And that was written in August, incidentally, the prior August, and June the 1st happened to be my first full day at a church in Fort Wayne, since an inner city church. And I worked there for 11 years and loved it. It was like I was suddenly where God wanted me. Well, I tell you, I was there 11 years, and I was at annual conference. And I don't know, have any of you been to annual conference? Okay, so it's a lot of fun, right? It's where all the pastors and the lay people, lay leaders of each church in Indiana come together for an annual meeting. And during that session, we do business. And one of the things that happened in 1993, that was a while ago, some of you weren't even born, right? 1993, okay. There was someone who had a motion on the floor of the conference that said to eliminate two church development positions, on conference staff positions. And that motion actually passed, and those two employees were eliminated. I mean, they weren't eliminated. The positions were eliminated. I'm sorry. Didn't say that quite right. Well, the next year, I'm at annual conference, and the leadership of the conference conference brings another motion, and this motion said, we're going to create a position for a church development. And I remember turning to my neighbor and I said, I feel so sorry for whoever gets that job, because the year before they had just fired them. Well, guess who got that job? That would be me. So one of the things you need to know, that as you figure out how you fit into God's plan, that sometimes God will put you in places you really never thought you'd end up, like that. So, and if you look in the Bible, God also loves to use the least likely folks, right, to do God's work. I mean, the least likely. You look at Moses. Moses is called to go free the Israelites from bondage, right? Egypt. Now think about it. If you were picking someone to go and lead the Israelites out of Egypt from bondage, would you pick Moses? After all, he was a fugitive, right? He had fled Egypt because he was a wanted man. He killed someone there. And he would be the last person, I think, you choose to go and free the Israelites, and yet that's what God does. And he says, of course, you got the wrong guy. I can't even speak. Now, I don't know, have you seen Ten Commandments, a movie with Charlton Heston? I don't think he lisps, but according to scriptures, Moses had a speech impediment and had trouble talking. And yet, God calls him. He ultimately says yes. He goes and is obedient, and you know the rest of the story. Gideon, same thing. Gideon is in the thrashing barn. He's hiding, and guess who happens to show up? An angel from the Lord, it says. And the angel says, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior. And Gideon's response is, oh my word, I am from the weakest clan, Manasseh. And I am the least in my family. You've got the wrong guy. And yet, what happens? He ultimately obeys God, and he ends up defeating the Midianites. And Mary, in the Bible, Mary, the mother of Jesus, last person you'd probably choose, right, to be the mother of Jesus. I mean, she was a nobody. She was a young woman. She was from a backwater town in Judea, not born from any royal line or anything like that, and yet she says yes to God and goes. You know, I've shaken my head at the places that I've gone. This last week, I was with fellow church developers, and you probably are wondering, what in the world is a church developer? Do they go around raising money or what? A church developer, in my word, is someone who helps the conference churches raise up new leaders, make disciples, start new faith communities, new churches, to multiply, is what we're all about. And so I was with my colleagues from across the nation this week, or this past week. There were about 50 people in the room. And as I looked around the room, I thought, okay, they're all pastors. Or their former DSs, district superintendents, or they have their masters or doctorates, and many of them have written books, books that I use. And I was thinking, God, how in the world did I end up in this room? I'm not a pastor. I don't even have a master's degree, if you can believe it. I have not written any books, so no book signings after this. But I just am like, okay, God, I wouldn't be the person that I would have chosen to do this work, but you've chosen me, and so I'm doing it. I happen to have the longest tenure of anyone in that room, in that position. It's crazy. Have any of you heard of The Upper Room? It's a little devotional book. I don't know if you've heard of that. I'm the chairperson of that board. So when we have to write contracts or legal documents, I have to sign them for the state of Tennessee. Why would someone like me in Indiana be doing that? Only God. There's a group in the denomination that approves curriculum. So we have to read curriculum, and then we decide whether it should be considered okay for United Methodist Churches. Believe it or not, we do that. And there's a little stamp of approval on the cover of curriculum that's been approved. I'm on that committee. Why me? I didn't ask to do that. I've been to General Conference, which is the global gathering of the church, six times. I went in 1984, I've been in 2019. And I'm the only layperson in Indiana who is on what's called an episcopacy committee, and we decide which bishops go where. Now, why would I be the one doing that? I didn't ask to do that. God. My point is not how great I am, because I hope you realize anyone that eats the same breakfast 6 days a week is pretty boring. My point is that there's no other explanation than that God had a plan for my life. And once I figured that out, God used me, even though in my mind, I didn't feel qualified to do those things. So each one of you, as you think about the plan God has for you, don't rule out anything, because God will give you the gifts that you need at just the right point, just the right time, to do whatever God calls you to do. And it's all for His glory, right?
Amen.
It's not for ours. So, yes, you have a purpose. Yes, I have a purpose. We have a reason to get out of bed every day. You're God's masterpiece, and God has a plan for your life, too. I'm going to end with this quote. This is from Dorothy Sayers, and it says, novelist Dorothy Sayers observed that Jesus experienced three great humiliations. The first was his incarnation, when he stepped out of glory of heaven to become a baby. The second was at the cross, where he took all the punishment we deserve for sin. The third, she said, was at Pentecost, which is coming up next month, when Jesus gave the church custody of his reputation. We represent him to the lost and the broken people of the world. It seems absurd that the Lord of glory would stoop so low as to entrust us to be his hands and feet, to share his heart with others, but he has. When we realize the depth of his grace, we will ask people to give him everything they have, because he deserves nothing less. And then, just as he's patient with us, we need to be incredibly patient with others as they grow, falter, fail, and learn. So, masterpieces, all of you, yes, you're lovable, and yes, you have a purpose, and so give God everything you have, because God deserves nothing less. And as you join God, know that He's with you no matter what you're asked to do. And even though it may be a bit, you may be a bit boring like me, or a ho-hum kind of guy or gal, God has a plan for you that is likely unexpected and extraordinary. Amen.
Amen.
Glory in the highest, I will shout.
goes something like this. A woman writes, have you ever just wanted, you woke up with an inspiration and it's so empowering and so inspiring that you just have to kiss the person next to you and just claim the day and seize it. Have you ever done that? And she goes on to say, I just did, and apparently I'll never be allowed to use this airline again. I thought of that story because, I don't know about you, but so many things happen in the life of the church that I find inspiring. And I think Ed's message is one of those today, right? I think there's so many things that happen that inspire us. But most of us, we take that inspiration and with some initial enthusiasm, we say, yeah, yeah, that's it. But then we kind of lay it down until the feeling goes away, don't we? May that not be you this week. This week, may you take that inspiration from wherever it comes from, and may you grab onto it and cling to it tenaciously, so that you too might be that bridge builder between Jesus and people who so desperately need him. It's through that inspiration that you make it happen. Can we thank Ed for sharing his inspiration with us this morning? So first things first, be inspired. It's around you, everywhere you look, just grab it and go with it, be inspired. Secondly, use it. Use it to make that difference, this day and every day. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord our God turn his countenance towards you and give you peace and strength for the journey, this day and every day. And all of God's people said,
amen.
Go with peace.